It's a great pleasure for me to welcome today to our discussion the Dirac Medalists of 2020, Professor André Neveu and Professor Pierre Ramond, together with Professor Miguel Virasoro, who was a former director of ICTP, and they were awarded the Dirac Medal last year. Unfortunately, Miguel is not with us anymore, so I will be interviewing the two of you. And this Dirac Medal was given for the inception and formulation of string theory, which led to new symmetries, both bosonic and fermionic. It introduced these new symmetries into physics. Namely, in your case, it was the world sheet supersymmetry and the space-time supersymmetry. And it is a very novel, very new kind of symmetry, which nobody had thought of before. And it has really has had a huge impact on the field subsequently in many, several years after that. So I just wanted to understand from you the history of this and what is your perspective on this. Because I myself am a string theorist, so I know how important and influential was your work. Because if you walk around in the corridors of any physics department, you'll often see string theorists at the working at the blackboard saying, Ramond, Ramond, Neveu Schwartz, Neveu Schwartz. So it must be interesting for you to see your name being sort of, you know, being pronounced all over the world in this manner. And you probably didn't imagine it when you did this work. So maybe let me start with Pierre. Incidentally, you're both French, but you did not do your work in France, right?
No.
You did not do your work in France. So, but Pierre, let me start with you, because in some ways, you're my academic grandfather. Because my advisor, Jeff Harvey, was your student at Caltech.
Yes.
And at Caltech, those must have been really exciting days. I remember these were the days of symmetries and particle symmetries, groups, mm-hmm. and so on. And your name in particular, you know, perhaps you had not anticipated it at the time. And I think it's particularly appropriate for the Dirac Medal, because your name is now even associated with Dirac himself. I mean, there could be mm-hmm. no bigger honor than that, that there
yes.
is a Dirac Ramond operator.
Yes.
And so I just wanted to understand, how did you arrive at this, you know, what was your path to the discovery of mm-hmm. supersymmetry?
Well, yes, it's like all these scientific things, you really do not know what you're doing at first, but you have an instinct that certain things are worth pursuing, and you pursue them. Most of the time it doesn't work, but in this case we were lucky that the dual resonance model, also known as the Veneziano model, had just been formulated, and it had led a lot of directions which were unexplored. And in the analysis of this, it which was coming purely from amplitudes, people started extracting propagators and vertices, okay? And the propagators certainly looked a lot like a generalized propagator for a point particle. And so my idea, which was developed a bit at CERN, in Aspen, was basically that maybe it looks like a generalized particle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
And because the string picture was not known at that time.
Well, yes, not to me, but it was known to by Nambu, much earlier. But I did not know, because all I knew is that there was these amplitudes. And at the beginning, correct me if I'm wrong, things were a bit, you know, compartmentalized. I mean, the insight of Nambu was not really shared by many people, but people had been working on this amplitude quite a lot, and they were extracting from it some simpler structures that were underlying these things.
Mm-hmm.
And I recognized that one of the simple structures was like a point particle, and I decided to pursue the analogy.
Mm-hmm.
In a process, I basically started, I found that the formalism was good. You could do it. It gave rise to, I recognized I had to expand the momentum to include harmonic oscillators. And then the square of this momentum had like the square of harmonic oscillators, and out came something which became known roughly at the same time as Virasoro operators. Mm-hmm. And it went on and on like this. And then, and after a while, I decided to generalize it to the Dirac equation. Mm-hmm. Now, Dirac was my god. Once I understood his book, at least I'm not sure I really understood his book, but once I appreciated the beauty behind his book, it was normal that I should
emulate him.
I should emulate as much as I could. And then I just followed Dirac in his generalization. That's all I mm-hmm. did. Mm-hmm. And in the process, all these symmetries kept coming up. And I did not realize it. I knew there were new symmetries. I didn't quite understand what they were. I don't think. But you see, Dirac was. I became acquainted with Dirac in. I never met Dirac. First time I met Dirac was at the ICTP in 1969. Mm-hmm. And is it time for a little anecdote?
Yes, please, because I think Dirac was a very close friend of the center.
Yeah.
And it's an association that we are very proud of.
This one is interesting. So my advisor, Balachandran,
yes,
okay, and before that, George Sudarshan, had gotten me a 2 or 3 month stay at the ICTP right after my PhD. Mm-hmm. I arrived here. And Dirac, soon afterwards, was there. And there was some conference in that conference room here. And I was sitting 2 rows behind Dirac, and I'd never seen him before, but I noticed his head was very small. and I couldn't believe that I was surprised. You know, out of the head came that. Okay. And suddenly, in the middle of the talk, there are steps coming down, rather noise, and a woman taps it on the shoulder and says, "Come on, Paul, you can sleep at home." Now, my musing of this was disappeared because one of my god, I finally understood once I got married, but the question is that, and Dirac meekly followed. But this is where I met Dirac, and I met, meeting is different. He was like,
saw him.
Saw him. And but that was here.
Ah, that's very interesting, because I think his wife was the sister of
Schwinger, of
Wigner.
Of Wigner, yeah.
Because Wigner always used to refer to, you know, my famous brother-in-law.
Father, yeah. Yeah,
because yeah. He was at Princeton when I was a student there. So
yeah,
I see. That's very nice.
But going back to the real thing, all I did was to follow the Dirac equation. Mm-hmm. I had to invent a generalization of the gamma matrices. I introduced oscillators for this. And I must tell you that once I started doing this, I was almost brought to a sense of awe, because I knew that I'd done something
which was
bigger than me, except I had no idea what it was. Okay? And in my whole career, this has never happened again. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just that, but as I said, we were lucky to be, you know, at the beginning of this fantastic field, right? Mm-hmm. Where we basically, by instinct, we just went after it, and then we found marvelous things occurring. Mm-hmm.
So maybe André, I can ask you, because you worked from a very different perspective, perhaps, and you were in Paris at that time, or?
No, I was in Princeton.
Oh, you were in Princeton?
Actually. Yes, the amusing thing is one of the turning points, I would say, of my career, in retrospect, was when I first met Pierre, and that's what I'm going to reenact with him tomorrow. But perhaps you saw a little bit of it, of what is going to happen tomorrow. No. But it was very amusing and a remarkable coincidence when we first met. And then after that, we kept in touch. And Pierre sent, when I was in Princeton, sent us with John Schwartz. I was interacting a lot with John Schwartz. He sent me his paper on the fermionic string, say.
This was 1971.
January or something like this, 71. Mm-hmm. And then with John, we thought that was quite interesting because we were, I am probably more mathematically minded than Pierre, and I thought that was a very interesting mathematical structure. But we thought that, oh, fermions, Dirac matrices, that's too complicated. And so we decided to build a completely bosonic model, which turned out to be the Neveu-Schwartz string, how it's called now. That's how, little by little, we discovered that it was working and that it actually worked very well when married with the fermionic string of Pierre. And that's how it all began.
That's the beginning of superstring.
That was ultimately superstring. Mm-hmm. In our paper with John, we introduced the word supergauge, which after that became supersymmetry. And supergauge because we thought there was a miraculous structure which was responsible for the fact that it all worked. Mm-hmm. And that was an exciting moment for mm-hmm. me, yes.
Yeah, for all of us, yeah.
For all of us, yes.
It's also, it's fascinating because, in fact, as it was revealed later, both your sectors were somehow essential for the more complete formulation of the theory, for a consistent formulation of the theory, right? Yeah. So even though you thought that you were doing bosons and he was doing fermions, they had to get together. So that's what I was joking to Pierre that he should come to this. He was debating whether to come or not because of COVID. Then I said, okay, we really need the Neveu-Schwartz and Ramond sector together.
To get together, yes.
To get space-time supersymmetry and modular invariance and, summing over spin structures of the Riemann surfaces. So all this was still not on the horizon.
Mm-hmm. All these pieces of the puzzle came together little by little. It took a few years. Mm-hmm. The projection, the GSO projection and all that, little by little, and space-time supersymmetry afterwards, yes. Yeah.
But I think the really important stuff is that, which is, I still cannot get over it, is that Dirac's, all of this stuff is based on Dirac's algebraic structure. And the fact that Dirac's algebraic structure is so potent, and that, for example, one of the things which a lot of people were worried about is that we were introducing fermionic operators which had apparently vector indices.
Mm-hmm. And it looked
strange. Gamma mu. But the fact is that when you go, and then it was learned later on that the superstring was working in 10 space-time dimensions. That means 8 physical dimensions. And in 8 physical dimensions, the spinner and vector representation of the little groups are the same.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I mean, and it had to be in
the,
because
triality of the spinner.
Yeah, I mean, that's completely amazing. So this great man, Dirac, put his finger on something. And then, of course, eventually many things came out of it, but without his impetus, it would not have happened.
No, also then later, as the Dirac equation has come to play also a very important role in mathematics, index theory, anomalies.
Yes.
And Witten has very deftly made use of the world line supersymmetry, so to speak, mm-hmm. To really reformulate the index theory, and it really crucially depends on thinking of the gamma matrices as fermions on the world line. So that concept, it's a very different way of looking at the Dirac equation, that it's a kind of your first quantized theory. You're just doing some first quantized theory, and it becomes the Dirac equation in space-time.
As Dirac says in his paper, he does mention explicitly, as I talked about tomorrow, was that he thinks of them as spin as the dynamical content.
Spin variables on the world line of the particle.
Yeah, I mean, so. So what can you say?
That's amazing.
So we were very lucky. We were at the right time.
Yes, yes.
And the only thing in our favor, I would say, is that we had the good taste of following the right people.
Well, I must say that, you know, when each time I hear my name associated with that of John, right, or with, I feel a little bit strange, because I know for sure that if I hadn't met Pierre 2 years before that, or a year and a half before, then the Ramon Neveu Schwartz string would be called Ramon somebody else string. Mm-hmm. Probably. Yeah. You cannot rerun history. But
yeah, but probably. That's impossible, yes.
It's impossible, of course, yes.
Well,
but you know, maybe I can make a digression here. So it would have been called by some other names besides Pierre. When, before Abdus Salam got the Physics Nobel Prize, I thought that maybe he could be a good candidate for the Nobel Peace Prize because he founded this institute and nobody else would have done it. Mm-hmm. Whereas we know, the standard model, other people found it also. So, well, Abdus didn't get the Nobel Peace Prize, but in my opinion, he could be more proud of this institute than of his scientific discoveries.
I think it's true, actually. I have talked to his family, and he certainly felt that this was a more lasting legacy.
Yes.
And I can certainly identify with that. I mean, he's my predecessor, the founding director of this institute. But also I share with him, you know, because he comes from Pakistan, I come from India. Mm-hmm. And I know how important is this vision to connect the world through science and to make the scientific resources available to the world around. Yeah. So I think you're absolutely right that this aspect of ICTP's vision is perhaps equally important, as important, or even more important than the scientific contributions coming out.
On a side thing I could tell you, in my career, I would be today probably a rich man, and I would probably be doing working for Google or somebody, okay? Because the beginning of my scientific career was here, because that summer that I spent in Trieste, okay, got me onto the track of studying these things. And André will talk later on a little bit about what happened. But on the way back, I mean, I was completely working on these things. I did not know what I was going to do, but I was working on these things. But I would say that the people I met here played a crucial role in my own career. And that is the lesson, that when you basically get people together in a pleasant environment, etc., things happen.
That is also very true, that you know, we really bring together some 5,000 scientists every year, and really from all corners of the world.
Yeah.
And just putting them together in this manner, both for science and for more general understanding, international cooperation, it's a very amazing thing that ICTP does.
And the other thing is that, going back to what André said, is that there are no nationalities.
Yes, yes.
I mean, in our field, I mean, if you can do some physics, if you can do this, etc., then that's it.
It doesn't matter.
It doesn't really matter. And this is wonderful. This is a wonderful aspect, and unfortunately, the society is slightly different.
Yes, yes. And I think, you know, but I think I share also Salam's optimism about this, that I think science can contribute towards bringing. And there are examples of ICTP's mission in that direction, like the Sesame synchrotron in Jordan,
where
through science you really bring people who would otherwise not talk to each other into the same room. But okay, going back, maybe André, I can ask you. I think Pierre sort of suggested that this discovery of the Ramond string was perhaps the most exciting moment of his scientific life. You have worked on many other things, I know, like the gross Neveu model, QCD, and so on. So what was, in your career, what would you say was the most exciting moment?
The most exciting moment? I think in retrospect, it was probably indeed, in retrospect, I feel very excited about how the first time we met, but in retrospect. Otherwise, probably, yes, when we realized that, the Ramond Neveu short string was working, or at least beginning to work, and obviously was going to work.
Yeah, it was going to work, yeah.
Probably. And mm-hmm. although we could not forecast foresee that it was going to go, it was going to go so far and have such a... so many consequences, mm-hmm. both in in physics, I'm not sure, but in mathematics, certainly.
Mm-hmm. Well, in physics, it has come very close. Huh?
Who knows?
With the heterotic string, it's a close call.
Yeah,
it's almost there. It's missing something. But
also, I think one of the things it led to was space-time supersymmetry.
Space-time supersymmetry, somehow.
That was also... It grew, I guess perhaps some Russians had arrived at it independently. I don't know the history.
Yes, there was Volkov and Akulov. There was a paper on a non-realization,
non-linear realization of
space-time supersymmetry. Yeah.
But I think Wess and Zuminov were probably
late.
They were perhaps inspired by...
Well, they were late. I mean, the Russians, Lichtman and Gelfand and Lichtman first, and then... a year or two later,
but they were not inspired by the supersymmetry of string theory.
At that time, the Russians
But also, Wess and Zuminov were not.
I think Wess and Zuminov were not aware
of string theory.
They knew about string theory. They knew about string theory.
But RNS string, they
well, they were working on two-dimensional stuff a few years before.
And they realized that at that time the two-dimensional supersymmetry had been discovered, of course.
Why not generalize it
to four dimensions?
Exactly.
That's what Wess and Zuminov thought. Yes.
But the Russians, independently. I mean, there was Volkov and Akulov came a little bit later, but Gelfand and Lichtman, basically, they wrote the basic multiplet, mm-hmm. yeah, uh-huh. and nobody paid attention to that, including the Russians.
Including the Russians.
Mm-hmm. You know, it is the way. The way it goes, mm-hmm. but that is oftentimes science. You know,
That happens.
This is the way it is.
So you know, in terms of the sort of the impact of string theory, you know, it's also space-time supersymmetry of the superstring, its connection with gravity, unification of all forces, mm-hmm. all this, and then later on anomaly cancellation
and all this.
You could not have foreseen, you know.
Otherwise, you would have worked on it like mad.
exactly.
But also, I think then later on, I mean, even though string theory has not yet made contact with the experimental world, it has really led to some very deep insights about the physics of black holes and holography. And, you know, very deep connection with gauge theory from a very, mm-hmm. through this holographic duality. So that's also, it's a completely unimaginable consequence of string theory, right? Yeah. And
You know, the fact of space-time supersymmetry, okay, is a fantastic tool for probing, physics. There was an interesting thing that, Wigner, at the urging of his brother-in-law, and looked at the representations of the Poincaré group.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there's a famous paper of Wigner.
Famous paper. But in that paper, you realize there are some very special representations.
Continuous.
Continuous ones, which are basically supersymmetric duals of one another.
Uh-huh.
One is helicity, is integer. Uh-huh. The other one is half odd integer.
I see.
Uh-huh. Yeah, which he called xi and xi prime. And since they did not occur in nature, nobody paid any attention to it.
Mm-hmm.
But they are there. And this was 1939 or something like this. So today, I'm sure somewhere in somebody's papers, there are some fantastic things.
So, Pierre, I know that, of course, you trace your intellectual lineage to Dirac and Wigner. I know that you love group theory, and also Jeff, my advisor, he was trained well by you, I think.
Yes, I know.
Which led to the E8 cross E8 heterotic string. I mean, that these kinds of really abstract and marvelous creations of, human mind, so to speak, like E8 cross E8. You would never come across something like that on the street or in any real context, right? But somehow, such a thing coming to play a role in physics, it's a...
Well, the standard model, if you extend it, it goes to E8.
Naturally.
Naturally, as we put in. And to that, we should mention Feza Gürsey. Mm-hmm. A great Turkish theoretical physicist who basically was obsessed by group theory and was very good at it. And I followed him, but, all these studies about the exceptional groups and everything, that was Feza gave the impetus. And it was, and therefore you said, and this was a Dirac thing, see? You said, oh, my goodness, we have these exceptional structures, like the platonic solids or something, okay? Therefore, nature must use it because it's stuck there. And this is the Dirac view.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
This is the Dirac
view. Yeah, sort of a very platonic, idealistic view, of which somehow has been quite successful, one would say.
Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. Doesn't work, but, there is this principle of beauty.
Yes.
Okay, which we all are basically customers of this.
Yes.
I mean, as Wigner famously said, the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics, right, in physics.
Yeah. Well, there is this paper of Dirac, a public lecture in the 1930s, where he talks about this thing. I mean, Wigner did not invent this stuff. Dirac wrote something about this. And basically that you have simplicity and beauty. Simplicity would be like the Newton's equation.
Mm-hmm.
Beauty would be like special relativity with extra symmetry. And at some and he says those are the guiding principles.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And he said things like which were completely amazing for the time. He said, why do we have a complicated universe? Because we have equations, but the boundary conditions
are
complicated because of quantum fluctuations. He said that in 1930s. Okay, so at that point, you see, it's like, when you go to the Musée d'Orsay, and in the Musée d'Orsay, there's a room where you have the Van Goghs, mm-hmm. and you walk into it, and it could be raining outside or anything like that, but suddenly...
You're sort of...
Okay, and that's what happens. And so
André, you made a French reference, so maybe what led you to do this kind of physics? I mean, were you brought up in the French school of training, or how was?
Since I was young, I wanted to be a scientist, really. So, and I remember when I was really young, after learning, when was that, in second grade or something like this, learning addition, subtraction, division, multiplication, I asked my father, well, what goes next?
Oh, really? That's fantastic.
Is that on?
Curiosity.
That is very impressive.
Curiosity. Yes. And then he told me how to compute by hand a square root.
Ah, mm-hmm. Really?
Which I have forgotten since then.
Yeah, it's not...
And so, since I was a good student, I ended up naturally at the École Normale, and then between physics and mathematics, I chose physics because, well, I was more interested by the real world in principle than by purely abstract constructions. So it was a natural path. Mm-hmm. I'm still on this path.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you, Pierre, did you grow up in the US or?
No, in France.
Ah, you grew up in France.
Yeah, I left France right after high school for a few years, and then the same thing, you know, you go in Paris, there are places you go to Palais de la Découverte, I think, if I remember correctly. But basically, the public goes and you have these beautiful Crookes tubes and you have this, yes, and you have that. And this makes a fantastic impression. The impression, in retrospect, the impression is that the complicated world becomes simple, which is quite a remarkable thing. And at the time, you don't realize this. Later on, you do. And so I just felt, you know, drawn by this, that there has to be simple stuff. Mm-hmm. And when I look at Dirac equation again, that is a simple stuff which describes a whole absolutely incredible things. So you must have had similar experience.
Yes, it's certainly. I think string theory, again and again, sort of gives you this sort of surprises. And even though we are still grappling to really understand what string theory is, there is somehow many people in the community cannot shake this feeling that there is some, it is really revealing some truth about nature.
There is probably still much more to be discovered
in
the structure of the theory, which we don't understand.
Yeah.
Yeah, what is your take on, I guess oftentimes there is a, sometimes it's called, what are they called? Paparazzis, you know. People have this very somewhat narrow view of science that, okay, if it is not immediately falsifiable, then it is not science. I think this, which of course does not correspond to how science is actually done, because people really play with ideas and, just by going by your hunch and develop them, and you have to actually develop them sufficiently to even put them to some falsifiable tests. And this is especially true in a field like string theory, where we have been able to make progress without a lot of guidance from experiments. So what are your views on this, from a philosophical point of view, if I may say?
Well, when you are facing such a, not complicated, but such a rich structure, it takes a lot of time to really extract from it something which will connect with some real experimental fact or some physical fact. See, for example, black holes, where ultimately some non-perturbative, I shouldn't say that, but in principle, since if string theory is finite somehow, then it should solve the problem of the singularity of at the center of a black hole,
yes,
and also solve the singularity of the Big Bang,
yes,
or at least provide a model for those singularities, which would eliminate them. I mean, it may not be the right one, but which could eliminate them and lead to further developments, I would think, in cosmology probably,
yes,
but nobody knows yet.
But
you see, we are, physics is such that we understand the universe on a very large scale and also on a very small scale, but not ultimately to scale zero, nor to scale infinity. But the scales where we understand us are very, very far from our world for the moment. And so it's difficult to have a falsifiable thing to put forward
immediately.
But who knows? Who knows? After all, quantum field theory, which seems a very abstract thing, is at work in a computer, you know, in a transistor.
In a laser.
And because it's, and so, so actually, yes, supersymmetry. Well, there is supersymmetry in nuclear physics.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So there are nuclei which are supersymmetric one from the other, and you can relate their properties through some form of supersymmetry.
I think in solid state physics,
also well.
Solid
state two-dimensional models of superconformal critical points.
So, but little by little, these things are being discovered, and their domain of applicability changes. But it looks like the view of the world, I mean, there are some theories, like the standard model, etc. I have no doubt that the problems with it will be solved when we put gravity into it, in a way, okay? And but there are other problems I'm not sure they will ever be solved. I don't know whether or not, given our universe, will be able to answer some questions.
Mm-hmm.
But nevertheless, you don't think about that when you practice physics. You just do it, and you're lucky.
Just
if if you have a model to work with, it's like, and then you find out what's wrong. And if there's a problem, you go beyond a little bit, and you go beyond, and you go beyond.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I think the picture of the scientist having deep thoughts is true for people like Dirac or Einstein or Newton, etc., or Descartes even. But it's not true for most physicists. Let's face it. I mean, we're attracted to something, and we do it. And we have the ability to do it to some point. I mean, we're not.
But also, I think Dirac himself said this, that somehow the equation is smarter than the person who invents it.
Right? Yes, that's right. Certainly it's true for the string model.
Absolutely true. Because it's really so mind-boggling what has come out of string theory. That, for example, you said about the resolution of singularities. I mean, already in string theory, even though we don't understand the black hole singularity or the early universe singularity, already some singularities like the orbifold singularity or the conifold singularity, which in normal geometry are singular,
but
the stringy geometry are not singular. So there is reason to hope that there is a new way of looking at the singularities which can change our perspectives. So.
There's also something. So in the history of the discovery of the standard model, I mean, the second half of my career has been very much concerned with phenomenological things, and I've not given up, but I have not worked on string theory. And the thing that is remarkable is that of all the particles in a standard model, that basically are the most interesting to many people right now are the neutrinos. And the neutrinos were particles which were the idea was invented in the mind of a theorist, whereas most other particles have been basically discovered in the experiment before.
Yes.
And as a result of that, you will find that the community, it's not true anymore, but for a long time did not believe in neutrinos, okay, because they were just invented in the mind of some guy, but who was answering a real problem.
Yes.
And now the experimental front of the standard model is on basically neutrinos.
Yes.
And we don't know. We know it's not finished. It's a history that is not finished. Mm-hmm. And after all, proton has to decay. whether we can observe, we will observe it in our lifetime is a different matter.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot more stuff going on, but. The important thing is the excitement of this.
Yes.
And I think at some point we've all been, both of us certainly have been tremendously excited to the point of not being able to sleep, not being able to, it was all encompassing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it was, you know, it's, I don't know.
Very good. So I think, yeah, tomorrow we have the ceremony. Yes. I'm looking forward to your lecture yes. there. Mm-hmm. Maybe do you want to add some comments to wrap up our
Well, I'm honored and completely delighted to have the name Dirac in this thing, because that is somebody that basically influenced my life. And not only that, but somehow opened up something which, you know, was a deeper appreciation of certain things. And mm-hmm. I was lucky enough to be able to contribute in that direction. Mm-hmm. But I followed mm-hmm. one of the outstanding physicists of his of the last century.
Yes, I think it's in this particular Dirac Medal is particularly appropriate. In its connection
so
with Iraq.
We thank you. We thank you. This is very good.
Would you like to
yes,
add something?
Yes, very good. And I must say, I'm only saddened by the fact that Miguel is not with us.
Yes, yes.
And Miguel is another one who was contributing a lot and then went to do
in
other things
direction,
in different directions.
Yes.
Yeah,
but continued to contribute.
Yeah. I think tomorrow we'll have a memoriam. Yes. For him, with talks from Veneziano and Parisi.
But he was different from us because he also had a sense of social responsibility.
Yes.
Which I'm not saying we do not have it, but we do not look for it. In other words,
he was also a former director of ICTP.
Yeah, right.
From Argentina, I can also understand that. Yeah, this mission of ICTP probably resonated with him also in the same way. So
early in his career, he left to go back to Argentina, and he could not. And then death threats against him, so he had to go back. That is a sad part. But anyway, we were completely
And André, you want to say something?
Well, I'm very honored by this this medal, and particularly happy to share it with with Pierre.
I think it's really
This is really nice.
Yeah,
yeah. I'm glad you could come, both of you.
Well, that's why I tried very hard.
Yeah, I'm very happy that you could make it in spite of the COVID.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Yes,
very good. So thank you, both of you.
Thank you.
It's an honor for me to actually meet the stalwarts of my field. So thank you. Thank you.